Sorry, guys. I didn't know you were here yet. Give me a second. Thanks for giving me a second, guys. Running a little late today. Part of the agenda is Lord Drew's making me actually go drop something off at the Firefly. Get a giveaway, so I just gotta go drop that off for a little, probably grab a couple of drinks, maybe get some pizza too or something like that, and then we got a few other things to do. So sorry about the mess in the place right now, but one of the things I gotta do constantly is put my books away. Now I'm a huge comic book collector. I've been collecting since I was 13 years old, maybe even earlier, I don't know, but just got some new books here. Right here is a Spider-Man with an Alex Ross beautiful cover. X-Men has always been my thing, so they got this new one here. This is just the sick Spider-Man cover. And of course, they got more Alex Ross again. He's been doing a bunch of new ones. This book is fire right here. And of course, one of my biggest collections is Uncanny X-Men. I have one of the longest runs out there from 97 all the way to the last issue of 530-something. And this is X-Men number 17. This is back in the 60s, so might not be in the best condition, but this is one of the earliest books I own. And it's just great to add it. Just great to add it. What else we got over here? We got some more Spider-Mans right next to X-Men. Spider-Man is up there with me. Got some Infinity War. This is old school right here. One of those double covers, Wolverine on the back even. Ugh. What else do I got here? Another sick X-23 or Wolverine. Not even sure what she's going by in this particular one. So many. Immortal X-Men number one. Another double-sided cover. You gotta love those. So these are some of those new books I picked up. But now, of course, I have this new obsession. And we've talked about it on the podcast a couple of times, and that's slabs. So I just got this week, and this is actually one of the first issues I actually bought when I was a child, like, you know, back in 89, I want to say, sorry, not 98. And this is signed by Rob Liefeld, so that's the creator of Deadpool, for people who don't know. So this was a really big book for me. This is an older CGC, but still fire cover. Love me some X-Men, so I just had to do it, you know. The first introduction of the new Suicide Squad right here. And this, just a great book. Another Signature series right here. It's actually a two-part cover. The next issue is actually the other side. But was sick, had to get it. And this, I just had to buy it for the cover. There's nothing special about this book, but it's just a sick cover. I had to put it to my collection. So one of the other things that we got going on that we're working on is a friend of ours is actually coming out with a comic book. Can't say too much about it, but she wants us to do some character designs and things like that. And whereas it's been a while since I've really done anything, I'm really excited for this. So this is still really rough and, you know, it's not done yet, obviously. But just putting some clothes on now, doing some character design. Figure with this one. She seems like she'd be the type to wear that high boot, you know? So just gonna do some little stitching over here for the laces. Obviously, I'll put more details into this later. And once I'm done with this, we're gonna be passing it over to my boy Drew. And he's gonna be doing the inking and the coloring on it. And this is gonna be a good project. There's a lot of character designs that we have to go through. So it's gonna take a while. It's not gonna be finished for a while, but I'm excited to at least get it started. And this obviously will not be the final design, but it's very, very interesting. A lot going on to it. Very female centric, and I'm excited for it. I think it's going to be awesome. Well, this is fun and all that, but I got a little time before I got to go. I want to have a nice tall boy and play some video games. Overwatch is on the menu today, and then we're going to go to the Firefly. So this is my gaming spot, guys. Gonna throw my Xbox on. Just bought a brand new TV over here, so gonna have some fun with that. Overwatch 2 is the game I've been playing a lot. Need to get my rank up, so got about an hour. Let's freaking go. All right, finally got in a game over here. Get this dub. It's literally the worst freaking map in the game. Cold refreshments in between kills. Makes me want to kill things. Ah, their whole team already freaking quit. Their whole team quit. Look at that. Ah, beautiful. And game's over. We just made the whole lobby leave. Friggin' amazing. This is the quote-unquote tapestry that I talked about in that one episode that Drew made fun of me for, okay?
This is gonna force me to put my tapestry back up.
I don't even know what that means.
Well, I know, I've showed you. I showed you it before.
I don't even know what the fuck that means, Biz.
I showed you this. So
this is something an ex-girlfriend got me, and it is a map of Ireland and a lot of the family crest for some of the bigger surnames, right? But it also tells you where that family originated from. That's what all these words inside mean, right? So in here, I was able to find all of, because I'm 100% Irish, at least according to Ancestry. So my dad's a Burke. So that's that family crest. My mom is a Dillon, which is right over here. Then we have a Farrell. A lot of lions in these. And all the way on the bottom, what Irish family doesn't have an O'Neill? Again, a lot of lions. So one of the really cool things I thought, again, Burke and Dylan is my mom and dad, right? So they're this close on the map. Like, at some point, they were going to meet. They didn't meet until they moved to America. But I just thought this is cool as hell. And I'm actually thinking of maybe getting a tattoo with all of those family crests on there. So this is that tapestry, and it's got to be hanging up on the wall soon. But I think this is cool as hell, and just wanted to share with you guys. All right, that's enough of my place. Gonna call an Uber. I'm gonna go drop this merch off. I'm in the same place I grew up in Brooklyn, but I'm still kind of close by. But the good thing is I have absolutely everything I need here. Right on the corner, I have a 24-hour spot. Two blocks away, I have my supermarket. Right around the corner, I have two pizzerias, a bakery, a vet for my cat, a hardware store, and a Mexican restaurant and a Chinese food place. What else do you need?
Guys, that's me.
Firefly. Got a little time to kill before I go and do Cask and Crow and meet up with Drew, who actually his family owns this place. So I'm gonna get a couple of beers and have a pie before we go meet up. got a pizza, some rice bowls, and fire fries. But what I really wanted to talk about, exactly how excited I am about where the direction of this podcast has been going. So me and Drew have been doing Cask and Crow for over 2 years now. We're going to be 3 pretty soon. And the numbers and the support that we've gotten from you guys at home has been absolutely amazing. And we just really want to thank you guys and just want to say we have so many things coming up and we have a lot more coming your way. We have a lot of projects on the way, and not only am I excited, you should be excited too. With Quinn, this is Drew's nephew, and one of the best selections that they have over here is their stout beer. So apparently there's a particular way that you have to do it, and Quinn's going to show me how to do it. I've never done a stout beer before. So Quinn, take it off.
All right, proper way to pour a stout beer is like this. You grab your glass, put it down. It's a little foam coming out, so you want to wait till it turns black, pour it out, go again. And you're going to want to let it fill up to about 3/4. It gets nice. About right there is fine. And then you want to let it sit and you want to let it rise. So all that rises up and it becomes like more so black. Once your beer is all rised up, she's black. You just want to top it off, give it a little bit of head pulse. There you go. All right, so you saw my pour. Now it's time to see if Biz could do his own.
All right, let's go. Let's try this out, all right? Said let it run for a second. Let it pour. Let it sit and rise.
Yep.
Then we do my favorite part, the head.
Not bad, not bad.
For a first timer, I think that was pretty good.
Not bad.
That's the way I did, all right? Yeah. Thank you, Quinn, man.
No problem, my man.
So I'm about to order my Uber. I got to get to the beer store, pick up a couple of beers, and then get to the studio before Drew gets there because we're about to record, and this guy's such a stickler if I'm not on time. I swear to God. Have a good night, man. Okay, so across the street, we have one of the best beer stores in the neighborhood, okay? Basically, any beer that you want, you can get there. And I need to pick some up before I go to the studio to shoot the next episode. Because again, if I don't bring beer, Drew gets a little annoyed. This is one of the best places in the area to actually get any kind of beer over here, mostly because they have multiple different beers that you're not going to get in any other store in the area. A lot of it is foreign beers and stuff like that. There's a lot of your IPAs. There's just a lot of your different types of beer. And who doesn't like a selection? We're not talking about your Bud Lights, your Miller Lights and stuff like this. We're talking about, what the hell is this? Marble of Doom. I don't know what that is, but I want to try it. Look at this. KCBC is one of a great brand, though. I just never heard of that particular one. But at least you can come in here and you can see a bunch of different things. You can try a bunch of different things. You might spend a couple of dollars more, but tell me it's not better than your $1.50 Bud Light. You know what I mean? Okay, so I got my beers. Gonna head to the studio and get there before Drew, because this guy's a fucking asshole. All right, so let me get these beers on ice and let's get this going. Beers are on ice. One of the things Drew wanted me to do before we get the show going is switch out the books on the wall. So let's do that now. Drew left a bunch of books out for me to switch. Let's go through them. And you know what? I'm going to give you a little bit of history if I know anything about it. So this right here, Spawn number one. I remember buying this book off the shelf. When Image Comics first came out, this is one of their biggest books. And to this day, it's actually one of the ones that actually holds any kind of value. And Spawn is actually the number one longest running independent comic book out there. So we're going to put this up here. We're going to switch it out with this Uncanny X-Men 282. This is actually the first appearance of Bishop, who is not only an awesome character, but I feel he's going to play a big part in the MCU when it actually comes out. As best as possible. Always take care with these things, because you grab it in the wrong spot and all of a sudden there's a crease that never goes down. It brings it down a couple of points. Always treat these things with respect. Beautiful book right there. Spawn number one, one of my favorite artists ever, Todd McFarlane, the creator of Venom, if you guys at home don't know. And that's kind of funny because this next book I'm taking down is the first Secret Wars number 8, the first appearance of Spider-Man in his black costume that eventually becomes Venom. So it's kind of funny how that one works. So we're switching this book out with Batman 500. And in this one, not only is this one of the first appearances of Bane, but this is the issue where Batman actually gets his back broken by him. And you get to see Azrael, the second person to ever actually be Batman. Whole different costume, everything like that. The storyline sucked, but at the same time, it was cool to see it. So let's switch this out. Little tidbit about this book that I'm about to put up. Joe Quesada, the artist, and who eventually became the editor-in-chief of Marvel at one point, liked to draw things, as we talked about before, in his art. And one of the things he used to do and got fired for was writing the word sex in his artwork. And if you go look over here, right in the corner, in the cracks, S-E-X. Don't get me wrong, it's not perfect, but he did it in every single issue until eventually he did one in Ninjak, a Valiant comic, and ended up getting fired for it because it was just way too blatant. Fun fact. Looks beautiful. So the next book we're taking down, it's Batman 423. Now, I'll tell you right now, nothing actually happens in this issue that is actually worth talking about. However, you get to see Todd McFarlane draw Batman. And this doesn't happen very often. This is the only image that I am currently aware of that he has ever drawn a Batman in an actual issue. He's done stuff before in like a crossover and stuff like that, but this is a cover, it's iconic, and it's just beautiful. So this issue, at the moment, is nothing, but it might actually be huge moving forward. So it's Peter Parker, the Spectacular Spider-Man, number 98. And obviously it has Black Cat in it, and it has the Kingpin, obviously. But it's also the first appearance of the Spot. Now, the spot is a very little-known villain, like a D-list villain, but apparently he's going to be in the next animated with, like, the Spider-Verse. So, let's see what happens with this. This might actually be a huge book moving forward. Dead number 48. So, this is the death of Laurie Judith. If you don't know who that is, that Laurie is Rick's wife and Judith is his unborn daughter. And also Herschel and the governor, who is a huge villain in the actual show. This is a huge book right here, but unfortunately we're going to retire it for the moment. This Kingdom Come number one. Now, not only is this one of the best issues, at least, that I feel that happened from the artist Alex Ross, who's iconic as far as I'm concerned, but it also brought about this futuristic era with the DC Universe where everything is so pessimistic and dark, and it was just a beautiful story, and the art was amazing, and it was just so new at the time. And I remember buying this right off the shelf when I was younger, and it blew my mind. And I'm so excited to put this one up. Spider-Man number 300. Sorry. We're just not taking that off the wall. How do you take that book off? And it's kind of paining me a little bit to take this one off. Because other than my second favorite book, other than X-Men, is Teen Titans. And this is the first appearance of not only Raven, but also Starfire. This is a huge book, and it's such an amazing condition that I barely even want to touch it, honestly. We're going to get to my favorite comic book ever, The X-Men. Not this particular issue, but this particular issue, even though it has five different colors covers, is actually the most sold comic book ever. Back in 1991. Personally, love when Drew Studd does this stuff for me, because I'm a comic book head, and I actually love looking through and seeing all these old books and, like, you know, reminiscing about stuff from my past, right? But it also lets me know what he's into at the moment and exactly what he wants to like, you know, talk about. And this actually shows on the podcast, you know. When I hear he wants to talk about Silver Surfer, he's really into that. Okay, I want to talk about the movies. Like, you know what I'm saying? How bad they were and you know, the rumors of stuff coming up. And things like this. And it kind of just works out just in a friendship way, okay? And especially if you're a collector and a fan, you love these debates. You love these talks. It's what you live for. And that's where that's what I love about the studio that we record in for Cask and Crow. Not only is just the books, but there's so many other little tidbits around here, especially if you're a collector or just love nostalgia like we do. Now, right here, this is something we got at Comic-Con last year. We just showed up at a booth that had, like, you know, old comic book cards, and I used to love this stuff. So did Drew. And they gave us these. These are just samples. They're not actually graded, but they got into graded cards. So we got this, and it was just amazing. If we did not show up there and be one of the first people there, we were not getting these. We showed up 2 hours later, and the guy was gone. This right here, this is one of the first gifts that we ever received from a fan of ours and a friend of ours, Jay. And he got us this Nutcracker, and obviously it's a giant Nutcracker. We're from New York, so we love the Giants, you know. And this is just an amazing thing. Love you, Jay. Thank you so much. This next one is a trophy. We actually, this is somewhat new. So we got this trophy, and we had a competition for our 100th episode. And go look and check it out. It's actually pretty fun. But my friend Drew won it, so this is his trophy. I wanted to bring it home. We put the Cask and Crow logo on there. Pretty cool. Over here, we have a gift from one of our friends and fans. Adam did the art for this, right? And there's so many different little tidbits in here that mean a lot to us as, like, you know, nostalgia people and just things from the show and everything like that. So it was absolutely great. And our friend Jay, the guy who gave us the Nutcracker, actually was the person that finally gave it to us. But thank you, Adam. This is amazing. We love it. It's in our studio. It's never coming down. This piece over here, and this looks like a worn out warning sign that you've seen a million times in your life, right? However, this one says, beware of giant schnauzer. And what you don't know at home is that my boy Drew actually owns a giant schnauzer. And if you've never seen a giant schnauzer, it's kind of scary, but in a beautiful way. She is a sweetheart, and she's amazing. She's called Stevie after Stevie Nicks, because Drew just loves Stevie Nicks. But it will kill you if it does not know you. And that's why this is over here. Stevie is beautiful, and Drew loves her. But do not mess with this dog, I swear to God. Brings to one of my favorites over here, okay? This is a Miller Lite Cask and Crow Podcast, 1853 Media Studio Lite. I'm sorry, how do you not love this? It's just beautiful. These are just little things that we just love in the studio, and we try and put up anywhere that we can. All right, so everything's squared away. Beers are on ice. We're ready to record. Drew's going to be here soon to do another episode of Cask and Crow. Thank you guys for actually spending a day with me, man. I hope you guys had a good time. Come join me soon. Card from his nephew, and it's a guy. How the fuck do you pronounce that? A dark Gyarados, and it's shiny.
Gyarados.
I'm sorry, I don't fucking collect Pokemon. I'm sorry, it's not my thing.